welcome each one of you into the house of God. Turn to somebody and say, welcome to the ocean of love. Amen. Turn to somebody and say, you have a destiny. How many of you believe that God has planned something beautiful for you? How many of you want to fulfill your destiny? I want to title today's message, Run the Race. Turn to somebody and say, run the race. Yes, yes. Run the race. Shout amen. You know, I want to tell you that each one of you have a beautiful destiny planned by God. But destiny is not for people who want to be comfortable. You can choose to be comfortable, relax, but then you will not meet your destiny. Destiny is for people who want to be, who dare to be uncomfortable. Close your eyes and ask God, Lord, I want the courage. How many of you need courage from God, grace from God, strength from God? Lift up your hand and say, I need courage. How many of you want to be determined to endure discomfort, to delay gratification, and to go where God has destined you to go? Throw a hallelujah. There are perhaps millions of people, millions of believers, who are sitting comfortably at home, watching the TVs. And they're dreaming that when everything is perfect, when finances are perfect, when their children are perfectly grown, when they have achieved everything, when their job is steady, then they will build their dreams. I guarantee you, turn to somebody and say, your life will never be perfect. Don't wait for perfect conditions. If you're waiting for everything to be perfect, your husband to be perfect, your wife to be perfect, your children to be perfect, and then take the step, you will never take a step. You will die before you reach your destiny. Don't wait for everything to be perfect. In the midst of your imperfection, you need to have your purpose, your goals set and walk towards them. Getting over the challenges. I love this verse, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. And I want you to stand up and read it aloud, the Word of God. With total respect to him, stand up and read the Word of God. All of us together, we are going to read this word and we're going to meditate, we're going to dwell in this word. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Turn to somebody and say, run the race with endurance. Tell that person one more time, you have to run a race of faith, not a race of sight. How many of you are ready to run a race of faith? Faith is you get into a top of a swimming pool and you're on the diving board, and right there's no water. And then by faith, you jump in. And as you jump in, water comes in. That's faith. If there's lots of water there and you want to dive, that's not faith. That's sight. And many people can jump like monkeys and dance like donkeys when there is water. But it takes courage that there's no water. Then you jump, and then God provides the water. Turn to somebody and say, you have to run the race of faith. Please be seated. God has planned something beautiful for you. God has planned that through you, He wants you to be a blessing. You are a blessing, and you will be a blessing to somebody else. How many of you believe that you are a blessing? And you will be a blessing. And God has set a course for you to run. And He wants you to run. He doesn't want you to walk. He wants you to run this race. And when you run a race, there are some simple principles. You cannot run a race unless you know where you want to run to. Ask your neighbor, where are you running to? You need to have a destination. You need to have a place where you're running to. I was just looking at the goals I set January 2019. Every year, I set goals for myself. How many of you know that you need to set goals? And in my goals, it is written by April 2019, I'll finish the Bible school. That's one of the goals. But it was not April. It didn't finish by April. It didn't even finish 100% by the time I went there. It'll finish by July. But how many of you know, at least you tried? Turn to somebody and say, aim for the sky, at least you'll reach the top of the tree. Turn to somebody and say, aim for the sky. Hey, come here. I'll just introduce you to the people. Come, sweetie and Nikita, please come here. I know both of you have to go. These are my children. This is my granddaughter from Oman. They're from our church in Oman. Give them a big God bless you. This is Sweetie. And this is Sweetie's daughter, Nikita.
Praise the Lord.
And she's a good singer. Next time she comes, we will practice and make her sing a song. Is that okay? Yeah? Can we all pray for them? Just stretch out your hand and pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for this beautiful family. And we pray that whatever you have destined for them will come to pass. That they will run this race with faith and endurance. Laying aside every weight and every sin that ensnares them. And Lord, they will run the race with absolute clarity. I pray for new mercies, new energy in Jesus' precious name. And all the people said, amen. Give them a big God bless you, please. It's so important that you aim. You should have a dream. You should have goals. Every one of you. Every one of you, you should have a dream. And you should have a hope. And dream high. Aim high. It is better than not aiming at all. Some people live their life as if they just want to Oh my God, such a bow. One more day, it's treachery. I just have to. No, you don't have a destiny. You don't have a dream. You don't have an aim. You don't have a goal. When you live for goals, when you hope for things, there's so much of joy inside of you for expectation. Because of the mere expectation of what is going to happen, you will have joy. And there are certain things that you need to do if you want to run this race with an aim to achieve your goals. And you have to run the race with joy. Acts 20, verse 24. Acts 20, verse 24. But none of these things move me, nor do I count my life dear to myself, so that I may finish my race with joy. Whether it was Jesus, whether it was Paul, they finished the race, even in pain, but with joy. How many of you want to finish your race with joy? Shout a hallelujah. Shout a hallelujah. Amen. One of the things that you should not do is, you know, just live a life, look after your children. I'm not saying you should not look after your children. Get them married. Then go back to India and die. It's not a life worth living like that. And however old you are, you need to have a dream. You need to know for sure that God has a plan for you, and His plan is fantastic. And you need to get the download of God's plan through you, what He wants to do, and do it. Don't wait for circumstances to be perfect to do your job. Shout amen. So I want to tell you, if you want, how many of you want to reach your destiny before you die? Reach your destiny. The number one thing is release yourself from the past. Release yourself. Turn to somebody and say, please release yourself from the past. Many of us, we are kept our past as. Linda, please come here. Come. Sit with the baby here. This message is for you. You need to release yourself from the past. Philippians 3, 13 to 14. Philippians 3, 13 to 14. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. One thing I do, I release myself from the past. Sit with Annie and T. Release yourself from the past. We hang on to our past. We hang on to our past pains. We hang on to our past fears. We hang on to the past darkness. Turn to somebody and say, release the pain of the past. If you want to run a race, there are weights, there are baggages with you, and you have to release yourself from the baggages. And if you want to run a race, you can't have heavy loads on your shoulder and then run. We need to release ourselves from the baggages. Amen. He says, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended. One thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forward to those things which are ahead. Ask your neighbor, can you change your past? Now, for example, I got married to Annie. Now, there's no point. I have to get married. Oh, if for 37 years back, if only I didn't go to Madurai. I went to Russia. Or I went to Chennai and married Sridevi. See, some of you are like that. You're still living in your past and hanging on and said, I made a grand mistake. Oh my God, if only I didn't make a mistake in the past. Past is past. Turn to somebody, it's over. If the milk is spilt, it is spilt. You can't do anything about it. Forget the past. Turn to somebody and say, forget the past. Live the present. Today you should enjoy. All the time, he loves the past. What about you? Look at your face. Enjoy this face today. Shout amen. Forget the past. Forgetting those things which are behind. Reaching forward to those things which are ahead. Get up from where you are. Turn to somebody and say, get up, rise up. Dream again. Imagine again. One more time. Say, dream again. Again. You know why God gave us hope? If you don't have an imagination, if you don't have a hope, then your life will become hopeless. Hopeless. You have to move on. Release the pain and get moving. When you begin to realize that your past does not necessarily dictate the outcome of your future, then you can release the hurt. You can enjoy today. People don't enjoy today because they are stuck with the past. Everybody take a deep breath. It is impossible to inhale unless you exhale the hold. Breathe it out. Say, breathe it out. You cannot inhale till you have exhaled, till what was inside has come out of you. And that's true for many aspects of your life. Release yourself from the past. You want to reach a destiny. You want to reach a goal. Don't think about the past. Reach a goal. Set new goals. Set new goals and reach for your goal. Release yourself from the past. Leave the pain. Leave the darkness. Leave that thing that intimidates you. Get on. I was once in a big problem. 5.5 months. Almost for 4 months. I was living in the past. If only I didn't make that mistake. I was crying. If only I didn't make that mistake. I was putting all guilt onto myself. I was accusing myself. I said, I'll never forgive myself for the past. What I did is horrible. It's not right. And I was keeping on saying. That's not what God wants you to do. Yeah, you made a mistake, admit it and move on. Turn to somebody and say, move on. Run the race. See, if you're running and you keep looking at the past, 99% you'll fall down. When you want to run the race, you don't keep looking at the past and run the race. When you want to run the race, you forget the past. Take off your shirt. Put light clothes and run the race, then you will reach the destiny. How many of you are ready to cut from the past? Good. Number two, if you want to reach your destiny, release yourself from the past. And number two, stop pleasing people. Stop pleasing people. Don't expect people to clap for you. Don't do things for people's appreciation. John 5:41-44. I do not receive honor from men. I do not receive honor from men. Whether men can clap, whether men throw stones. I have a destiny and I will reach the destiny. I have a goal, I will work towards the goal. Shout amen. I don't care whether people like it or people don't like it. They honor me, don't honor me. The next verse says, but I know you, that you do not have the love of God in you. I come in the Father's name and you do not receive me. If another comes in his own name, him you will receive. How can you believe who receive honor from one another and do not seek the honor that comes from the only God? Read that again, everybody together. Say, how can you believe? How many of you want honor from God? Lift your hand. Turn to somebody, look at their face and say, I don't need your approval. We don't have to please anybody. So we were expecting 250 students, only 175 registered. And only 75. Some, they could not take 2 weeks holiday, like Ash. He had 6 days, so he came for 6 days and he went. I can understand. Many could not get their holidays. So people came, only 75 sat through the Bible school. So some people, they need a big crowd. If they see 500 people, then they can preach. If they see 75 people, ayo. They're moved by numbers. In my experience, numbers is not what matters. Numbers is good. But out of 75, even if a few catch the vision, it's done. I'm not there. I said, I'm not here for people's clapping. You know, the best testimony was just after the Bible school, within 2 days, one of the boys who got baptized, he goes into a village, he examines the village. He said, I'm going to make a difference in this village. He went and saw that school was closed. He said, I'm going to do all it takes to restart this school in this village. Amen. And not one, another two boys, they've started a research. I tell you, the results of what these 75 people will do, we'll come to know in the months to come. Shout amen. We should not be there to please people. Stop pleasing the people. Take this message. You don't have to please your husband. You don't have to please your wife. I don't have to do anything to please my wife. I have to please God. Turn to somebody and say, please God. If you start pleasing people, you will never reach your destiny. You should have confidence in your instincts. You must never allow other people, their refusal or their faith in you or their data to refute what you know intuitively that it is true. Don't let other people stop you from running your race. Turn to somebody and say, run your race. Stop pleasing people. Do you have an aim? Run it. Do you have a dream? Go for it. Is the dream from God? Run that race. Shout amen. Hallelujah. Shout a hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because God likes people who seek honor from Him. He says, your faith also, you cannot run with faith when you start to please people. Number three. Identify the lies you believe. Turn to somebody and say, you believe a lot of lies. Seek the truth. One more time. Say, you believe a lot of lies. We just took in the Bible school. Sarah, you remember? We took a summary of all the students, the lies the students believe. Guess what? I had 12 pages full of lies. We just discovered the lies people believe. Because unless you know the truth, you will never be free. Unless you know the truth, you will not run the race with endurance. If you believe something will happen, that will happen. Because everything in the kingdom of God is by faith. If you believe, turn to somebody and say, if you believe, you'll see the glory of God. And the devil will do everything, put all kind of messages into your head so that you won't believe. You'll fear. All kind of fears. Identify the lies. Change your mindset. Turn to somebody and say, change your mindset. Change your attitude. You know what is attitude? Attitude is the reaction of what you believe. It's a sum total of what you believe. If you don't change your mindset, if you don't change your attitude, you will never reach your destiny. You will be played around by circumstances. Circumstances will just push you around. You should have a clear goal. This is what I want to achieve. My mind is set towards that goal. And if I believe that can happen, that will happen. Everything is possible for those who believe in Christ and they know the truth. Shout amen. Somebody asked me, Pastor, how do you think 7,000 villages can be reached? I said, simple. I called one of the men of God who was there and I said, Pastor Mubarak, how many churches, how many villages do you visit? He said, 20 villages. Pastor Mubarak from Punjab, Mubarak Masih, he oversees 20 villages, one pastor. Guess how much we support him? 2,000 Indian rupees a month. The rest he will raise. He wants a small support of 2,000 rupees and he looks after 20 villages. I said, if I can find 350 Mubarak Masis, I can cover 7,000 villages. Hallelujah. You can do it. You can do it. If you believe, you cannot reach, you cannot reach. It's all based on your belief. So I pray that each one of us will set goals. We'll have a dream. I have a dream about my family. I have a dream about Chris and Mega. I have dream about Calvin. I have a dream about Annie. I have a dream for each one of my family members. Ask your neighbor, do you have a dream for your family? You should have a dream for your family. You should have a dream for your future. You should have a dream on what you want to achieve. And you should run. How many of you are working? Only those who are working, not doing business, wave your hand. Okay. People who don't do business, but who are only working, stand up. I want to see you. Who are not doing business, who are working. Wow, that's quite a lot. I have a dream for you. Please sit down. Please sit down. Please sit down. I want to explain this dream to you. Turn to Ecclesiastes 11, verse 6. I'm going to put on the glass, put on a new glass, and I'm going to talk to you. Ecclesiastes 11, 6. Let's all read that. 1, 2, 3. One more time. One more time. And then read on. Can I read Elias Jacob translation? You will not shoot me. This is my translation. In the morning, you go to work from 9 to 5. In the evening, you should do a business after 5. For you do not know whether you lose your job or keep your job, but you will prosper. One more time I say, in the morning, you go to work from 9 to 5. You sow a seed. But this seed, if this does well, you'll only get a salary. But that guy who has employed you will get all the profit. He will not share it with you. But in the evening, don't tell me you can't do it. Don't tell me I'm too old. I was 24 when I came. I worked for Al Buhaira Lucknow, selling milk. I was an accountant. Morning 9 to 5, I used to work there, Al Buhaira Lucknow. 5:30 in the evening, I'll take a car, buy wholesale plastic, and go to supermarket after supermarket and sell it till 11 o'clock in the night. Only thing, after earning all this money, I went and played cards. So that's another story. But what I'm saying is, turn to somebody and say, you can do something, you lazy guy. Slap that guy and say, you're lazy. You can do work and business. Think creatively. Think out of the box. This is Bible. It says in the morning you sow a seed. What are you doing in the evening? Sitting and watching TV. Sending WhatsApp messages. There are people here who spend half their lifetime on WhatsApp message. I want to burn your mobile phones. Come on, if you want to clap hands properly. Can you just imagine how much time you spend? Nobody in that mobile phone likes you. They say like all jute. Shout hallelujah. Do something here. Do something. Morning you sow a seed. In the evening, do not withhold your hand. You can be imaginative. Get your dreams back. Get back to work. Shout amen. I was taking this class in Love India on financial management. I tell you, I don't know about others. I liked my own message. So Dr. Sam came after the meeting and he told me, Pastor, you should give this class to every student. So I'm preparing a new series for the MBA students, BBA students. I decided to go and teach them. I want to teach the church. Church, jobs may be difficult. Jobs you can lose. But start something small. Even however small it is, don't just depend upon your jobs. You don't know which seed you will sow, it will prosper. Do something. Don't waste your time. If you can do a job and a business, do it. If you can do job, business, ministry, do it. Go for it. Because God has given us the earth to rule. Psalm 24:1. Let's all read that together. Everybody, read that together. One more time. So the earth belonged to the Lord. And all his fullness means every part of the earth, all the companies in the earth, all the people in the earth, everybody belongs to God. SAP belongs to God. Sharjah government belongs to God. It says the earth is the Lord's and all its fullness. The world and those who dwell, every 6-7 billion people belong to my God. Turn to somebody and say, the company you work belongs to God. How many of you believe that? Clap your hands and say, everything belongs to my God. Now go to Psalm 115, verse 16. Let's all read. The heavens, even the heavens, are the Lord's. But the earth, one more time, but the earth, one more time, the earth, turn to somebody and say, the earth belongs to you. God said, I'll give you authority over the earth. Whatever you bind here, it'll be bound in heaven. But earth, you have to bind, you have to loose, you have to do something about. You cannot sit and pray, Lord, millions will come to me and you do nothing about it. No million will come to you. You'll only pray and die. Shout a hallelujah. You know, you got to sow a seed. And seed is not some prophet coming here and say, you come and meet me, I will give you 5 apples you give me and 5,000 nonsense. What is that? I'm so sorry that I put you through this. I respect the prophet, but I told him to his face, it's not acceptable. If he's done, I apologize to you. If any prophet comes here and asks you for money, that's not legal. No prophet is allowed to do that. I told that prophet, don't do it. I respect prophecies. But I don't respect greed. That is pure greed. Shout amen. I thank God that some people messaged me and said, I said, don't go meet that prophet. If he has a prophecy, it has come beautiful. But we are not going to give any apples. If you want to give, buy nice apples and give him. The earth he has given to the children of men. So you need to do something, because nothing will happen unless you do something. I cannot sit and say, Lord, give me millions and I do nothing. Get up and work. Turn to somebody and say, God will bless you. It's the lie that you believe that on the earth, God will not do anything unless you move. He decides, he can do anything at any time. But he wants you and I to move. If India has to be saved, I need to do something about it. I don't know whether I can save the whole of 1.4 billion people, but I can make a difference. And I want to challenge you and tell you, you can make a difference. Turn to somebody and say, you can make a difference. Age is not the limit. Sex is not the limit. Your money is not the limit. It's just your attitude is the limit. You set your own attitudes. You set all lies in front of you and you believe you cannot. You can. Turn to somebody and say, you can. In Christ, you can do it. Forget the past. Turn to somebody and say, rise up and run. Hallelujah. Stop pleasing people. Get a goal and get running. You don't have to please anybody. Please your God. How many of you are ready to please God? Identify the lies you believe in. Shake the shackles and get out. Amen. Shout amen. How many of you are happy? You can do it. Turn to somebody and say, you can do it in Christ. Number four. Stop depending on human love. What is that? I didn't hear that. Yeah, 90% of the people are, you know, just there, dragging on to please their wife or husband. Some of the wives, they pulled on their husbands like nobody's business. I feel like slapping some of these wives. Pah! Their insecurities, their problems, they'll put the whole load on the husband. Don't do that. And some husbands pull down their wives with their insecurities. I cannot depend upon Annie. Her mood one day might be rocket high, another day she'll go and make her bed in hell. And if I go according to her moods, had it. It's not that I should not pull her out, but I'm not going to be dependent on her love. I'm going to be dependent on God's love. Turn to somebody. If your husband is next to you, women, this is your chance. Look at his eyes and say, I'm not dependent on your love. I'm dependent on God's love. Stop depending on human love. 2 Corinthians 12, 15. 2 Corinthians 12, 15. 2 Corinthians 12, 15. Because husband and wife blackmail each other. Can I be honest? Husband and wife blackmail each other. If you have not seen it, please let me know. Don't allow your wife or husband to blackmail you. Yeah, let's read. 1, 2, 3, here we go. And I will very gladly spend and be spent for your souls. Though the more abundantly I love you, the less. Everybody read that. The more abundantly. Listen, Paul is saying, there's some people who don't love you back. Stop depending on that love. Develop your love with God. And the more and more you're filled with God's love, you can give God's love to the person who's not loving you. That's the whole idea. If I start to depend on Annie's love, and Annie that day cannot give me love, I'm finished. But if I depend upon God's love, I receive love. The days she's feeling down, I can go love her. She will irritate me, sit on my head, scratch me, I still love her. Shout a hallelujah. Turn to somebody and say, stop depending upon human love. Some children, they look for dad's love all the days of their life, their mom's love. No. Matthew 10, 37. I love this verse. Matthew 10, 37. Let's all read. 1, 2, 3. Here we go. He who You know, I loved what Chris said in Kodaikanal. My faith in Christ is not based on what just my daddy. If God takes away my daddy, I still worship the Lord. It's not dependent upon a human being. How many of you want that kind of resolve? It's not dependent on my husband, my wife. And the moment my wife or husband is taken away, that's finished, the end of the earth. No more faith. No, 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 no. He who loves father, mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me, there are people here who love their son more than their God. Turn to somebody and say, are you? I'm not saying you should not love somebody. But your first love should be God. So he said, lay aside every weight. Run the race. Release yourself from the past. That's one weight. All the burdens of the past. Release yourself from the past. Number two, people are a weight. Their expectations of you. If they have unrealistic expectations, just go blank on their face and say, sorry, I can't meet your expectations. I'm here to please my God. I cannot meet your expectations. I'm not going to compromise my resolve for God for your expectations. The third weight is the lies you believe. Your own limitations, you know. What stops you from achieving your goal is your own limitations in your mind. The lies you believe. Take it out and you can do extraordinary things. Number four is depending on, you know, because most people are emotional. They love the love of some people. And these some people can be a burden. Instead of encouraging you, they can keep discouraging you all the days of your life. And you need to shut off that. Not that you should not honor your father, honor your mother, honor your husband, honor your wife, no. Honor your children. I remember once my mom told me, hey, you're born Jacobite. You have to be a Jacobite. You have to die a Jacobite. I was baptized. Somebody told I'm a pastor. I said, how did you become a pastor? He said, if you leave the church, you should cross my dead body. Emotional blackmail. I said, Mom, I love you. I love you so much. You are my favorite. Mom is my favorite. So I said, I love you so much. But I'm going to be sorry. I tell you, I love my God more than I love you. Later, when there was a problem at home, I told, because my first category was, number one was God. Number two was my mom. Number three was Annie. Because Annie I came to know only a few years. My mom, from birth I know, she delivered me. But one day, I took Annie and mom. I told mom, listen, I've changed my priorities. You're going to be number three. You know, my mom wept whole day. That she cried like a baby. She was so disappointed with me. I said, no, you're going to be number three. This girl is going to be number two. It's not that she's very good, but I just have to be. This is godly principle. From that day, fights ceased between mother-in-law and daughter-in-law. Some of you, your mother is above your wife. Poda, I feel like giving you one slap. Your mom is not above your wife. You need to change your priorities and keep that in your mind. Your dad is not above your wife. You need to have the priorities in relationship. God first. Your wife, your father, your mother, nobody is above God. None can interfere in your relationship with God. That's a weight. That's a weight. And you have to leave that weight and run the race. Number five. Do not be controlled by money. Money, everybody say money, is a big weight. Money is a big weight. Money is not evil, but love for money is evil. Money is not evil. There's nothing wrong with money. Money is good. You need money for transactions. You need money to make friends. You need money to generate resources. There's nothing wrong with money. But money should not control you. Turn to somebody and say, money should not control you. Luke 16:13. No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. I'm praying next year we will have at least 2 crores for operational expenses in the mission field. Not from the church, generated from India for India. 2 crores. That's just operational expenses, not capital expenses. So there's nothing wrong with money. But that money will not control me. Turn to somebody and say, let money not be your boss. You cannot serve God and money. God should be your head. Money should be your servant. You don't have to serve money. Money should serve you. Money should serve you. Later on in this verse, in 16 verse 9, there's something earlier that Jesus said, and I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon. Make friends for yourself. Use money to make friends. Use money to buy gifts. Use money to make friends. There's nothing wrong in using money. You have to use money powerfully. You can use it. And I pray that each one of you will prosper well. You'll be wise and you'll do extremely well. I appreciate people who prosper. Good. So that you will use the money to make friends with this unrighteous mammon. That when you fail, they may receive you into an everlasting home. Shout hallelujah. Amen. Turn to somebody and say, sow a seed in the morning. Do not withhold your hand in the evening. Shout hallelujah. Amen. I pray that our church will be full of entrepreneurs. All of you, I'm praying that all of you will be entrepreneurs. Start small. Start small. Sow different seeds. Every one of you will be good in business. Shrewder than everyone in the world. Shrewder, sharper than everyone in the world. Because we need to be blessed to be a blessing. Shout amen. Number six. Don't give excuses. Let go of excuses. Turn to somebody and say, let go of excuses. Luke 14, 18 to 22. Luke 14, 18 to. Let's all read. 1, 2, 3. Stop, and say, stop giving excuses. Start serving the Lord. If you want to give excuses, everybody can give excuse. You know, I have this problem, I have that problem. Once my boss told me, I was working in a secular world, he told me, Mr. Jacob, there's one thing I like about you, which I don't find with many of these guys. I'm paying them, some of them, fatter salaries than you, but I like this about you. I don't like these things. Because they come to me with problems. But you come to me with problems and solution. I'll never go to my boss with a problem, with an excuse. If there is a problem, I'll go to tell him that this is the problem, but I recommend this is the solution. You can give excuse. Anybody can give excuse, any excuse. But what's the solution? How many of you believe that God, Jesus, is a solution maker? If Christ is in you, then for every problem, you should come up with a solution. You yourself, stop giving excuses. Let go of excuses. Come with solution. They all began to give excuses. I bought a piece of land. Next, verse 19. This guy said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen. I'm going to test them. I ask you to have me excused. Another said, I married a wife. This wife is a problem. Turn to somebody and say, stop giving excuses, please. I'm going to make an announcement. And this is with my wife's permission this time. This is that I told, Annie told me that very soon she's going to start a training class every Saturday. Every Saturday. Because when I went, you know, I tell you, the training will be done. If Pastor Elias is not there, Annie will do it. The training is to raise counselors. I found out that when I went to Kodai, I found out that out of the 30 students and another 30 came from Punjab, 60 students, most of them needed help. They didn't know the basics. These are children. If we help them, they will shine. What can two of us do? I would like to go next time with a team, with some of you, trained. How many of you lift your hand and say hallelujah? I said, we are not going to wait. You start giving the class. You start to train. In 6 months, we can train. We go help people out of their dungeons. Turn to somebody and say, stop giving excuses. And the last I want to cover today, live a life of integrity, a life of truth. A life of integrity, a life of truth. Means you don't have to please anybody except God. Before God's eyes, are you walking straight? Forget about your husband, forget about your father, forget about your mother, forget about your wife, forget about your children, forget about ex, forget about anybody. I'm going to ask you one question. In front of God, are you walking straight? Don't correct others. I'm talking about you. Are you walking a life that in darkness, when nobody sees, you still say, Lord, I walk upright before you. Because he who walks with integrity walks securely. A righteous man walks in his integrity, his children are blessed. Proverbs 10:9 and Proverbs 27. Live a life of integrity and truth. You know, many of us can, I can fool my wife. For years, I've been fooling her. Till one month back, I got a nice wound in my back. And the wound, this guy said, your sugar level is high. It is, if you don't take care, forget about the healing. So for the first time, I started to be strict with my sugar intake. And it healed. Everybody say, please, let's read that. He who walks. Are you walking with integrity? I like this verse of 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 6, what Solomon said, something very wise. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 6. I want you to read. Worship team, come. Come on, boat. 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 6. And Solomon said, because he walked before you in truth. It's not that he didn't make a mistake. But the moment he made a mistake, he fell down and said, I repent. I'm not saying you will not make mistakes, but don't stink in the mistakes. Get out. Turn to somebody and say, get out of your mistakes. Get out of your bondage. Worship team, I have this word for you. Everyone in the worship team, come. Elders of the church, I have this word for you. God is saying, we will fulfill our dreams if we walk uprightly before him. You don't have to please anybody, neither your wife nor anybody, but we have to walk straight. Live a life of integrity. Live a life. He says, you have shown great mercy to your servant David, my father, because he walked before you in truth, in righteousness, in the uprightness, in the integrity of his heart. And because of that, you continue to be kind, not only to him, to his sons. He says, because of that, you have made his son sit on his throne. My brother, my sister, live a life of integrity. And I pray each one of you, as you go today, you will have big ideas, big dreams, new dreams you can achieve. Leave those things that ensnare you. Run the race. God has set something beautiful before you. Dream again. Have big ideas. Don't stop. Don't just work for people. Don't spend your lifetime working for some third party. Work for God. I'm not saying you should not do a job. Do a job. But you can do more. I don't know about you. I'm 64, but I have big dreams. I keep dreaming. How many of you are ready to dream with me? Lay aside the past and say, it's never too late.